Maraming salamat, Nova. Magandang hapon po. Sabi nila eh, katatapos lang daw ng ulan, mabuti na lang hindi namin tinamaan. So, ang presentation po ay Promoting Innovation for Inclusive Development in Southeast Asia, Challenges and Opportunities for Universities and Research Councils. And I plan to discuss four major topics. What is IID? What are the IID challenges in Southeast Asia? And what has been the UNITSEA response? The UNITSEA OA, Universities and Research Councils Network on Innovation for Inclusive Development in Southeast Asia. So meron pong DIA, nakita nyo, United, parang United Nations, pero Universities and Research Councils, nakatago yung Research Councils, parang SEARCA, no? Nakatago yung GS, Graduate Studies. Pero hindi na nila pinalitan, hindi na intermediate council. So, napakakamalan kami UN agency, hindi ho kami United Nations agency. But yung Southeast Asia is really Southeast Asia. And ito pong project namin ito ay tabakbo ng tatlong taon at ang pinagtunan ng pansin ay field building and capacity development, paradigm shift in higher education and research, building a community of excellence, and policy contribution at the institutional, national, and ASEAN levels. And then, pagkatapos noon, I will try to give project insights about the challenges and opportunities facing universities and research councils in promoting IID. Meron mo bang mga hindi marunong mag-Tagalog dito? Minsan napapatagalo ako, kaya yung mga estudyante kong hapon dun sa Ateneo, maya nagtatas ng gamay. Sir, I don't understand. Okay. And of course, the main context is that natapos na ho yung project namin. It ended in March this year, so we ended a three-year engagement, which is full of lessons. And we thought we go around and share the lessons. So what is innovation for inclusive development? I see inclusive and sustainable development in your literature. So I know that you are one of the units in the Philippines that already understand and are oriented towards inclusive development. Not too many universities and research councils and centers use the term inclusive development. Well, our understanding of inclusive development is that, well, innovation for inclusive development, IID, it refers to innovation that reduces poverty and enables as many groups of people, especially the poor and vulnerable, to participate in decision making, to create and actualize opportunities, and to share the benefits of development. So it is really a pro-poor, pro-marginalized strategy. And the idea really is, if you look at the base of the pyramid or the bottom of the pyramid, where we have a lot of people, right? Society is a pyramid and there are a lot of people at the base of the pyramid. These are your informal settlers. These are your squatters, ito yung mga taong grasa. Well, we have a lot of them in the Philippines, and as of now, one out of five Filipinos is still at the bottom of the pyramid, which is a big chunk of society. And if you listen to the rhetoric nowadays, they say, oh, tumataas nga ang GDP natin, the economy grows, but the poor remain poor. They haven't changed. In fact, there is a dynamic that some poor become non-poor, but those who are already non-poor become poor again. So, para silang palipat-lipat dun sa poverty line. And we need to do something about that. So, actually, kung titignan mo, the people who are at risk of poverty are more than the 20% or so that we have now. But the idea is that if you have a pyramid, and we have the base of the pyramid, the idea is that you are able to move people from the base so that they move to the middle class. And that the pyramid becomes a diamond. And you will see that even in democratic theory, they tell us that a big middle class is what you have. You don't want to have a society where a lot of people are very poor and a few people are very rich. That is not very good for any political system. So there is a coincidence that what is good economically is also what we want for democracy to work. And how do you lock off segments from the base and move them up? Well, we have CCT now, right? The conditional cash transfer, which is really a fast track method of bringing people who are not able to help themselves, keep themselves in school, and who are not able to get medical attention to be able to move up. Of course, if you look at other societies that are more socialist, they have more robust ways of taking the poor out of the base. For instance, sa US, kahit na TNT ka, hindi pwedeng wala sa eskwela mga anak mo. Di ba? Have you seen that? You may be TNT, but your kids must be in school. And they must regularly have their eyes checked. They must have their dental, their teeth checked. Because that is part of the services of society. You may not have a lot of income, but if these services come to you, and if you are assured that you don't get hungry, then that is one way of getting people out of poverty. Of course, the main thing we want is that people have livelihood, you know, because if you have livelihood, then you can take care of yourself. But of course, to have livelihood, you have to be educated. And so it turns out that education is so important in giving people the base capability for living life. So this is an idea, and this is not only for us in the Philippines, this is an idea that is happening worldwide. And the discussion about the base of the pyramid is very robust. For instance, a lot of companies now no longer look at people at the base of the pyramid as if they were just customers. They are now beginning to look at them as partners. Because they see that if you put the combined buying power of the people who are poor, for so long as you sell them sachets of shampoo, smaller soap, and so on, then they will be able to buy and you will be able to sell them a lot of things, right? And we now are experimenting with selling medicine through boutiques, letting the boutique become a retail store for a lot more things. Of course, you know now that the store is the main distributor of loads for cell phones, which, well, before they did not have that kind of importance. Now you cannot live without the neighborhood Sarisari store. So even in business, they look at the base of the pyramid as a source of business. And they also look at them as partners. Okay. Now, of course, the reason why we are looking at the innovation for inclusive development challenges in Southeast Asia is because we have so many poor. In fact, what we are doing now is competing with one another to make sure that our poor become non-poor as fast as we can. And the winner in that particular category is Thailand. In Thailand, they don't have any poor people anymore, right? They have practically solved their poverty. You will see a lot of beggars once in a while, but as a society, they have solved it. What they have not solved is their political turmoil. Okay? And in that sense, we are in a way luckier than they are. We are a more experienced country than they are, I mean, in terms of making democracy work. In fact, we had visitors the other week, members of their reform council, right, who are writing their constitution. They came here to find out, how do you do your commission on human rights? How do you run your COMELEC? How do you do your commission on audit? So they're trying to learn from us. Of course, we try to give them everything that we know. Of course, we also know that it's not only the provisions of the law that is important, but also the spirit in which you make the institutions happen. But anyway, we are all in this together. We are friends in ASEAN. That is important. People say we will eventually become something like the European Union will be, who knows, a Republic of ASEAN once in the future, thanks to China maybe, for the kind of pressures that it is bearing on us, for us to come together, right? But we are already in the threshold of an integration, and so if you look around in the whole world, after the European Union, the ASEAN is one of the most successful organizations. Kasi hindi natin kinakalburo, di ba? I mean, we wait patiently until we get everybody on board. The Indonesians say, musyawara, but we are patient, we are Asians. We are not like the Westerners who always put deadlines. Okay, so what are the challenges in Southeast Asia? Well, the problem is that more than a billion people still live in multidimensional poverty, and our Gini coefficients are from 0.34 to 0.44. And the higher the Gini coefficient, the more unequal a society is. And guess who? Which of the countries is one of the most unequal?
Philippines and Malaysia.
Oh, Philippines and Malaysia, right. Okay, but we don't have the kind of racial problems they have in Malaysia. So it's something, I mean, what we have in the Philippines is solvable. I mean, it's something we can do something about. And this says, over the past 10 years, measures of income dispersion have deteriorated. So as you can see here, our Gini coefficient has increased by 4% over the past 10 years. But if you look at Thailand there, they have reduced, right? So that's what we mean. And when you look at the poverty rates,
that's Thailand there.
And the Philippines is the one you have coming from the top, diving, but still one out of five Filipinos is poor. So this is the main concern. And we are saying, how do you get the poor out of poverty? Now, we are about to go into elections again. What are people saying? Well, hindi naman nagbago yung buhay namin. I mean, they read about GDP increasing, but many people feel that they remain poor. It is as if they are not part of the nation. Now, I'm a political scientist. One other implication of that is sometimes they become so cynical that they say, ah, kung sino na lang, kung sino yung pinaka-matapang dyan o yung pinaka-radical mag-isip, yun na lang yung iboto natin, baka biglang magbago pa ang sistema natin. So, it has political implications as well. Okay, so, but basically, these are some of the statements we have. Growth and development do not necessarily transform the bottom of the pyramid. Yung trickle-down, masyadong matagal yung trickle-down. Also, trickle-down development eventually splits a country into the formal, modern, progressive, productive sector and informal, poor, vulnerable, underprivileged, marginalized sector. Many people in the world today are studying the formal and the informal sector, or the formal and the informal city. It is a tale of two cities. When you go around, you see the formal city and the informal city, right? Lalo na from the air. In fact, they have even invented a photogrammetric or visual way by which, just from the photograph, you can identify whether they are squatters or not. The colors are different, the structure of the houses are different, the sizes of the lots are different, so from the air you can just count. So the technology for finding the formal city and the informal city is already sophisticated. No matter how fast we develop, the base performance score remains. What percentage of our people remain poor? For development to be inclusive, now this is the most important statement. For development to be inclusive, the poor must experience economic growth at a faster rate than the rest of society. Diba? Because if they just develop at the same pace, then they will remain at the base of the pyramid. So how do you make that happen? Now I wonder whether our presidential candidates even understand what we're saying here, that you need to come up with dramatic measures. Dramatic measures, kaya naman innovation ang pinag-uusapan natin because we think that innovation will help. So, we say, without social innovation, dramatic results in solving poverty are difficult to attain. BOP transforming innovation must occur at various levels. At the base of the pyramid, meaning informal sector enterprises, right? Social enterprises. In the way development actors work, use of science and technology, in policy and governance, role of political parties, conditional cash transfers, innovation in the organization of and interoperability within national innovation systems. You have innovation systems, but the parties do not talk, they are not interoperable. What does interoperability mean? Well, you look at what happened in Mamasapano. The police and the military were supposed to be interoperable. They were not, right? So if you're not interoperable, there is no teamwork. It's just like, mabuti pa yung computers ngayon, interoperable, right? Mac and Windows, doesn't matter. You put in the USB, it will read the file. There was a time they were not. You remember that time when OS, Apple and Windows, they will not even read the disks, but now they do. Mas mabuti pa yung mga inanimate objects. They are able to come up with interoperability. And interoperability you want is plug and play. What does that mean? We don't have to work together, we don't have to bond together to do work. If you get assigned to ARMM and you're supposed to work with a team from different departments and you're meeting for the first time, when you go out the next day, you should already be able to work as a team. I mean, that's plug and play, interoperability. Do we have that? Even in government, we don't have that, right? Okay, so anyway, we're just trying to get some ideas on what is required. Now, in our project, we were happy that there were 3 years from 2008 to 2011 that we were preceded by a project called Innovations at the Base of the Pyramid in Southeast Asia. So we were called, or they were called IBAP Asia. We came in, this thing that I have here came in after. But from 2008 to 2011, there was money to try to come up with innovation. So that project gave $10,000 to $20,000 for innovation projects in health, agriculture, energy, sanitation to applicants from Southeast Asia, including faculty members, researchers, students, NGOs. So it was a very good experiment, right? And they had up to 1 year to finish their work. And we were able to, I say we because we inherited that project. They were able to come up with 26 innovation case studies. And this is called Pathways Out of Poverty Innovation with the BOP in Southeast Asia. You can download this from the internet. We are going to give you the websites a bit later. But just to give you an example of what we were able to start, let me just, I may not be able, there. These are the 26. For instance, from Vietnam, an innovation on clean water supply for fishing village along the Red River. Okay. Then carbon filtration drinking water systems in Thailand. Development of an appropriate water filter for clean water supply in rural areas in Indonesia. The impact of water pods to increase resilience and self-reliance of vulnerable populations through community-led provision of water, sanitation, hygiene, WASH. Services and appropriate technologies, Philippines. Tonle Sap floating waste and sanitation treatment barge, Cambodia. Is it doon sa Tonle Sap, which is their lake, right? Kung saan sila umiinom, doon sila dumudumi. I mean, hado-hado lahat. So this was a new project. Pwede ba natin ipunin lahat sa dumi ninyo? And then we are going to dry them and then use them as fertilizer. But you have to train people. You have to come up with the software, the hardware, and the people where to make that happen. So that's just one project. Closing the loop between sanitation and food production. Philippines, development of a multiplex rapid diagnostic test for differentiating four major infectious diseases with fever as the major symptom in Indonesia. The Hapinoy Health Care Club, a hub. And then EcoLife Cafe, community learning space for climate change adaptation in Vietnam. A mobile phone interface for small-scale fisheries to access fisheries-related information, Philippines. So they report ng mga fishermen yung conditions, yung mga species na nakakatch nila, anong size, and so on. So it comes into, goes into a database. S&T in a box. How do you teach science and technology in elementary and high school? Is there a basic package that you can use? And then, Bali and multiple handicap system. Payment strategies for those with irregular incomes at the BOP. How do you manage? Meron ka tindahan yung kita mo sa tindahan, tsaka yung pera mong personal naghahalo. Hindi mo alam kung kumikita ka o hindi. Things like that. Business development services for enterprise and BOP. Waste cooking oil as jitney fuel, technology, evaluation, adaptation, and business development. Aha, Las Banias ito, di ba? That's a Las Banias case. I don't know whether that case is sustained. Turning natural waste into organic fertilizer, safe and affordable fuel, biofuel, clean fuels for the poor. Developing metal value creation through a value chain analysis of bioethanol and palm sugar production from iron and NIFA plants, solar power technology, etc. Anyway, this is just to give you an example of this initial experiment of trying to find out what are people able to invent or innovate in, where you bring in academe and NGOs with the communities together. So this is what we had. So that when we came in, the unit SEA, we were formed to encourage universities and research councils to promote innovation for inclusive development. And so it was met as a regional project with the Ateneo School of Government and the National Research Council of the Philippines as the two implementing units. The Ateneo for universities and NRCP for the research councils. But we were organized separately. We had separate members of agreement, so we had to learn how to work together. Be interoperable. Kaya nang napakalaki ng word na interoperability, because while we were parallel, we had to try to work out a lot of administrative issues. But we were able to do it, and we were happy that we were able to attain a level of collaboration that was very good. Now, the network is now formally organized as a network of individual advocates for IID in Southeast Asia, because the project ended, but we decided to continue it, and it is now based at the Development Studies Program, where we are now helping develop a master course called Master of Arts in Inclusive Development Studies. Right? The idea being, yung ating mga inclusive development workers o professionals, hindi nila alam kung anong kurso kukunin nila, at least yung mga nandun sa Manila. Magpa-public ad pa sila, magbi-business ad pa sila, mag-social work pa sila. Bakit walang course that puts together all of the theoretical, practical, community engagement, social enterprise courses that they need to be operate as inclusive development professionals in local governments and NGOs. So we thought maybe to say Master of Arts in Development Studies, too many of those courses, like in other like inclusive development studies, then you really have a focus. So that's what we're trying to do. So now I'm teaching a course on social innovation today, which is really trying to see how you can hijack a regular course in Ateneo and try to formulate it into a community engagement type of course. Sometimes you find out your students, they don't have poverty fluency. Akala nila yung balonggay tinatanim sa paso. And sometimes it's really very sad that they get to the point where they become professionals but they don't know anything about poverty. Some of them have not taken a tricycle in their whole lives. At makakasakay lang ng tricycle, magpapasalamat sa akin, sir, mabuti na lang, I took this class, nakasakay ako ng tricycle na nakasakay ako ng gym. Anyway. So, the network, what we did was we established partnerships with target universities and national research councils in the region. We could not do it for all, so pinili lang namin. And so we were able to have regular partnerships with 10 institutions, and these are the National Research Council of the Philippines, which is the National Research Council. Yung kanyang government part in Thailand, the National Research Council of Thailand, which is also, and then the Dewan Riset Nasional, the counterpart in Indonesia. Then the National Council of Science and Technology Policy of Vietnam, which is also their national research council. And for universities, we have the Ateneo de Manila University, Chulalongkorn University in Thailand, Wasan University in Vietnam, University of Malaya, Institute Pertanian Bogor, and Institute Technology Bandung in Indonesia. So we had these. The network has also forged ties with the Association of Schools of Public Administration in the Philippines, of which 200 public administration schools are a member. Of course, including I think Los Baños and the ASEAN Universities Network, which is the main network of universities in ASEAN. So we were able to partner with them. And we ran an IID Fellows program with them. And the unit series has engaged researchers and practitioners in 9 out of 10 ASEAN countries. So, pati yung mga nasa Myanmar, Cambodia, Laos, we were able to engage them. The intended outcomes were universities in developing countries conduct research on innovation for inclusive development, science granting councils in developing countries fund research in this area. Because when you look at our councils, how much money do they spend for proper research? Right? We made a presentation to Picard when we were just starting. Almost the same presentation, except that we were just forward-looking, we were just starting. But after our presentation, after talking about innovation for inclusive development, they started to look at, nung nag-umpisa tayo, ganyan tayo, we were helping the poor small farmers. But over time, because of the pressure to go for economies of scale, big value, suddenly yung mga palalaking players na tinutulungan nila. Because of our presentation, nasabi na, I think we have to go through another strategic planning exercise, sabi nila, to recheck yung kanilang priorities. But that just tells us that there are a lot of institutions that hopefully can help, but they don't have the focus yet. Governments and international organizations develop policies that support innovation in the informal sector. This is what we want. But informal includes the informal business sector, but also in the informal sector as in squatters, right? But as you know, Well, as you know, our informal sector, including our squatters, are still uncared for. Because we have a project called Transformative Urban Resettlement in Metro Manila, and we see them in Pantibulacan, we see them in Calawan, we see them in Cavite, and they are all so disappointed. Anyway, so what we're saying is that ang daming kulang sa dapat natin gawin. And the IIT program goals that we had, we wanted to come up with knowledge generation through systematic research on innovation in the informal sector and linkages with the formal sector to find out how to transform these marginal innovative activities into sustainable livelihoods. Field building. Ito medyo ambisyoso. Can we create a field called Innovations for Inclusive Development? Can that be a new field where there will be master courses maybe and professional courses? Well, we are not alone. IDRC has been pushing this, and there have been international conferences on IID. There are groups. If you Google, you will see a lot of groups that are working on this in Latin America, in Africa, and in Asia. So field building. Capacity building through peer exchanges and global collaboration with research networks, in particular to build Southern researcher leadership in the field. Policy influence by providing evidence of how policies, regulations, and institutions such as intellectual property rights become incentives and or bottlenecks for innovation within the informal sector. So we also wanted to have some say in policy. And so we've had these institutional partners, and we've had 128 network fellows. Basically, yung network fellows namin, sabi namin, if we are going to spend some money, maybe we should outsource some of the research to people who are already out there. So what we did was, we made an open call. If you are in the university, you are in the NGOs, you are in the private sector, you are in the community, if you are trying to teach a module or come up with a training program that you have started but you want some money so that you can develop it to maturity and be able to disseminate it, apply. And so we got this 128 network fellows. So some of them are, for instance, in Laos, I think, there was this lady who has developed a module for teaching literacy using newspapers. She would gather the old people, the mature people who did not know how to read and write, and she would do this. So we had this 128 network. So the idea is to generate innovative courses that can be shared with the rest of the world. So all of these are now available in our website, and so you are welcome to look up these modules and training courses that have been developed. And we have also funded research projects trying to find out what are the IIT policies in Southeast Asia, for instance, in the Philippines. What are the IIT policies? How about in Vietnam and so on? And we've also tried to map IIT initiatives. We've tried to find out what are the regional coordinating mechanisms like AUN in Southeast Asia that can be perhaps used as infrastructure for promoting IIT and so on. We also had a project, a challenge program for national research councils. Can we change the way councils like the National Research Council of the Philippines receives proposals, evaluates them, and decides on who will get the money? Very small amounts to begin with, but sometimes it takes one whole year. And if you don't change the system, you're supposed to submit proposals that are already complete proposals the first time you submit. Wala man sila yung capsule proposal so that you have a preliminary evaluation so that if you pass, they will tell you, okay, you can now submit the full proposal without your consent. Here, you have people from the provinces submitting full proposals that can run to 100 pages thick, only to find out that they don't make it great. So, are there ways of improving that kind of system? Why do you want to improve that kind of system? Because then you can also encourage many people who are not the usual applicants, maybe from communities, from inclusively minded people to apply. Of course, you have to change the criteria as well. This is one of the things we have been doing, deliberately trying to come up with a curricular development. So, as I'm saying, we are trying to do this in development studies in Ateneo. We were able to encourage one of our partners, Wasan University, to introduce an IID course as part of their GE course. And it is now required of all Vietnamese students in that university. Sabi namin, bakit ang bilis nyo? Sabi nila, we're Vietnam. I mean, they don't discuss too many things. Their governance system allows them to be quick and nimble, right? So, ang bilis nila. So, they now have these two courses, which is used there. Then we went to Chulalongkorn, and so we asked them, you have a master's in international development, MAIDS, Master of Arts in International Development Studies, MAIDS. Would you like to try out an inclusive innovation for inclusive development course? They said yes, on condition that you help us teach it. Right. So I was there for one month in January to co-teach the theoretical portion. But the students were actually practical students, and they were going to be assigned to the border areas where they have Myanmarese and Cambodian and a lot of OFWs. They are just like us, very much interested in NGO work. So I think they will retain that. So these are the small wins. In Malaysia, they didn't call it innovation. They didn't call it inclusive development. They call it sustainable development. But still, by sustainable, they mean you have to include everybody. So I think there is a case, because it's really understood that we are lacking in theory and we are lacking in policy in this area, and that universities and research councils are not doing enough. Yet, when you look at their motherhood statements, right? They always talk about poverty, social justice, human rights, but when you look at what they do with their NSTP, right? They are practicum students. I mean, there is no continuity. They fill them semester in and semester out, but there is no continuity. They go to the same Aita villages. The Aitas, napagod na sa kanila. Kasi ulit-ulit yung tanong nila, so bakit hindi kayo gumawa ng system by which what you learn from previous batches, you pass on. Just like a doctor who takes over, but he has a flip chart, right? He looks at the patient's history. Anyway, so many things we can do. But remember, the reason why universities do that is because they are doing it for their students. They're not doing it for the poor. The poor, in a way, are props in the learning process. And so we were able to do this, and then actually, so these are some of the things we also came up. Sabi namin, if you're getting worried, this we better create a source book. So we came up with a source book on innovation for inclusive development, and it has a lot of readings. It has modules, graduate and undergraduate level, so you can look at that. Then IDRC said, we have some more money. How do you want to pilot your IID? So we said, oh, we would like to pilot a professional course at the local government level. So we developed a course. It's called Project Design Course for Inclusive Local Development Professionals. And we run it in Hayan-stricken Northern Cebu. So Bogo, Santa Fe, Bantayan, Dapantayan, and Mandideos. And the idea there is that you run them through this course so that they can engage their communities, really discuss with them, find out what they need, to the point where they are able to come up using project management design tools to come up with real projects that are fundable. And so they were able to do that. At the end of the course, their mayors listened to them. The mayors were very impressed, and I think some of these projects are already being funded by the mayor. So the idea is come up with innovative initiatives or starts, and you let local governments do it. So it's a course, and I think we're going to run that course over and over. I think it took us the prototype course is 6 days, 3 days theoretical and 3 days community engagement and practical. Of course, we taught them project management, and luckily there is a project management software that is available, that's free, Project Libre, and so we use that. Even in teaching them lock framing, it becomes easy because there is an available lock frame software called Lock Framer. So we make full use of technology to very quickly teach what we need to teach. Okay, so this is the course development source book I was telling you about. Capacity building within universities. We came up with a computer-aided intake of proposals intended for the NRCP. And we also had some training programs for them. But the idea is, pag-submit mo na kayo ng capsule proposals, so you get capsule proposals from all over, then you screen those, and those who pass the screening, you tell them to submit full proposals. But we also changed the criteria. You have to change the criteria because now, many of these research grants are being given as, well, many of the applicants submit their pet projects. They always imagine it's going to help the poor, but they don't even ask the poor communities whether this is going to help you or not. So we are saying now, if you are going to make a proposal, you must present as your co-maker the target beneficiary community and all the intermediary organizations that are going to help you. So that from the very start, you already have some check whether the idea has resonance with the poor communities. So that's just one of the criteria that we had. But we set it up, of course, as to whether it will be used, we don't know yet. Because it takes time before you can change the rules of organizations like the NRCP. But we have shown them how it can be done. Okay, so these are some of our criteria. And we have templates, we have scoring, we have computation rules, and so on. Then we ask them to use that system of criteria to come up with an effort to shift the focus of their research. And these are the initial researchers that they got using that new system. So you have in Indonesia, science field shops, agrometeorological learning, and the provision of climate services to rice farmers. So that's IID. Philippines, sustainable food systems of indigenous peoples, linking nutrition, agroecology, and culture towards food security and resilience. Okay, that's another. In Thailand, motorcycle taxi drivers as community surveyors. They know their communities. They know they're moving about. They have a lot of information. How do you use that information? If you are an urban planner, or you were a social worker, right? You just give them the templates and they will give you the information. So
that's fine. Then
Vietnam, innovative accessibility map applications for people with disabilities in Ho Chi Minh City. So this is demonstrating that when you run, when you purposefully refocus research, you can do it. Make them more IID. Okay, so the IID Fellows Program, I already told you about it. We asked people who have developed modules to submit them to us, and we had a contest. And we partnered with the ASEAN University Network to make sure that there was some prestige and trust and confidence in what we were doing, because people don't know UNIT SEA. So the first hurdle was we had to convince AUN that we were trustworthy. So we worked with them and we met with them and we got their imprimatur. They worked with us, they were happy, and we were also happy. So, but that kind of networking and borrowing the prestige of other organizations to make a good project work, that is also important. We also have an inclusive innovation hub where we, this is also available on the internet, you might want to look at it. We have over 200 resource materials contributed by individuals and institutions. So what we did was we went around with kindred spirit organizations and asking them to sign a memorandum of agreement with us so that they will share their data with us. And these are the organizations that did that. We have them from Vietnam, Singapore, Thailand, Malaysia, even from India and Step Center in the UK. So very rich source of materials that are available on our inclusive innovation hub, which was intended to backstop the curricular development that we wanted, and also to promote the research and IID. And so you might want to look at this is our website. We have a Facebook page, we have a Twitter account, we have a YouTube channel where you will see our activities and our community engagement work, and also a Scoopy page. Now, influencing policy, we produce policy briefs. We ask teams to look at the five most IID-oriented policies you have in this country, and then we ask them, take a deep dive, focus on one, and give us a case study. So that's what we call a T method. Give us five, a survey, and then choose one, and give us an in-depth. So we have 25 cases and 5 in-depth case studies. But those are also available from our website. And so we also try to influence policy. We were able to, well, basically our partners adopted IID. So you now see it in the informal pronouncements of the National Research Council of Indonesia, Thailand, even in Vietnam. DFA has been working with us. They want to adopt it for the Philippine chairmanship of ASEAN. And it seems that they find the word inclusive sexy. Hopefully they follow through with real programs. But we think that this is a very good program to sell to our policymakers. Anyway, let me now try to end this. These are ASEAN level. This presentation will be with you anyway. Now, what are the challenges and opportunities for universities and research councils? This is now Project Insights. And basically, we find out that the key to inclusive innovation, which is the meat of IID, it's inclusive innovation. You cannot innovate for the poor. You have, they have to be part of it. Innovation of, by, and for all, right? Which is what is wrong with many innovations that is happening now. Kahit na para sa kanila yan, kung hindi sila kasama, it's not going to be sustainable, it's not going to work. Now, it is elusive to governments because governments look at them as beneficiaries, not as citizens. And it is elusive to private sector because they look at them as consumers rather than entrepreneurs. Buyers lang sila. Elusive to NGOs because they are just project partners and not development partners. And elusive to community-based organizations because many community organizations are autocratic. They are not participatory. So even within their own organizations, makikita mo na kulang ang participation. So we think this is one of the areas that we need to promote. Now, how can universities and research councils do more, teach more, and promote more community engagement? So I think that's basically what we need. But this is a simplified process that we had. Basically, we're saying you cannot work with all of them. Some poor are pre-entrepreneurial. So work perhaps with the entrepreneurial poor. Yung talaga na pupursiging mga. So you have to discover them, but you always have to work from a position of co-dignity. If you talk down to them, kung ang tingin nila masyadong mataas, ang tingin mo sa sarili mo, if they don't have your trust and confidence, you don't have the trust and confidence, it's not going to work. They have too much development fatigue already. Then you work them through co-diagnosis. Don't go there with your evaluation of the problem. Right? You have to extract it from them. And that requires what they call technology of participation. Diba? And you have to learn tools like scenario building. Diba? Scenario building is rehearsing the future with them. Kasi kung you rehearse the future with them, ano kaya ang possibilities 20 years from now? Nasaan na kayo? Oh, dapat po meron na kaming hospital. Paano kaya tayo magkaka-hospital? Then suddenly they realize na hindi sila magkaka-hospital kung hindi sila nag-uusap-usap. Eh ngayon, hindi sila nag-uusap-usap. So scenarios are put it in your toolbox. Learn how to use scenarios for making people accept plausible decisions now. How can you use it? BBL, for instance, Bangsamoro, basic law. Bakit mahirap lunokin yung Bangsamoro basic law? It does not tell you what the future is like. You don't have vision A, vision B, vision C. So, paano ko pipili? You are showing me a means to get there, but you're not showing me where it will take me. Mahirap yan naman yun. But that is up to us to come up with these tangible tools for leading our people to where they can make comfortable decisions with one another. So co-design, co-delivery, co-deployment. And between co-design and co-delivery, this is really prototyping. The science of muddling through. You always say to prototype, prototype, prototype. Learn to be effective, kahit na magastos. Learn to be efficient afterwards. And only then learn to expand. Don't expand if you have not learned to be efficient. And then don't learn to be efficient if you have not learned to be effective. So anyway, you will remember that from David Fortin. We use Philippine case, diba? To get that nugget of wisdom. Learn to be effective kahit na magastos ka. Learn to be efficient. And only then learn to expand. Okay. And ang problema sa ating mga universities, yung involvement of universities are usually at the individual level. Yung mga nag-outreach, yung mga nag-extension work, di ba? And it is basically a hobby. Sometimes they don't get any credit for it. Right? Wala dun sa kanilang promotability criteria o masyadong maliit. Pero gusto lang nila. Kaya na pag-iiwanan sila, hindi sila napopromote. Kung sino yung mga tumutulong sa community, yun ang hindi napopromote. Diba? I don't know whether that's the case here in Los Baños, but in Diliman, That's our case, our XYZ. Diba? Ang focus is on research. Peer journals, peer-reviewed journals. But saan nanggagaling yung mga criteria na ganyan? In a developing country like the Philippines, it is as if we are studying the problems that have been identified paradigmatically by the West. Diba? They are outsourced to us. Their paradigm problems. We don't have time to look at our own problems. Anyway, why universities are not IIT ready? Universities are highly prismatic organizations. They are diffracted functionally into administration, instruction, research, outreach. What? They are diffracted horizontally into disciplines. At hindi nakakapag-usap yung mga disciplines niya kasi kanya-kanyang conceptual frameworks, walang interoperability. They have few transdisciplinary interoperable problem-oriented centers. But once you put them in problem-solving mode, suddenly mag-merge yan, mag-blend. Kasi kailangan nila yung mga tulong ng mga engineers, business ad, social science. But they have to be in problem-solving mode. So you need more centers like that para naturally mag-merge yung mga disciplines. Yun, hindi na sila nagkukan eh. Hindi na sila masyado nagpapayabangan eh. When they have to solve a problem. And when you are solving a problem, you are really a consultancy firm, right? You are there to earn money. In fact, you can earn money. So, isn't that a good way of organizing many of our excess or redirect some of our efforts in universities? It's not as if we have too many people looking at our problems. People are now just asking, nasaan yung mga programs of government? Oh, where is the program of government for agriculture? Who's going to make it? You think the presidentials will do it? Or somebody will have to offer it to them and they will say, I like this, I don't like this. So, completed staff work. Who will do that? Who is going to pay for that? I'm wondering, right? So anyway, the incentive structure favors individuals, not teams, right? Span of attention is semesters and trimesters. What if the problem is a five-year problem? And nag-iiba yung estudyante mo. Lack of institutional memory for real problem-solving engagement with communities and authorities. Where is your database? Longitudinal and cross-sectional. No front desk for community engagement and services. Dito namin natutunan yan eh. Pag yung NGO gusto mong lapitan ng Yubilos Banyos, hihingi ng tulong, saan sila pupunta? Is there a front desk? Is there an NGO desk? Diba? No. I don't know. Narinig ko lang sa inyo yan. But I think it's a good idea. How do you make yourself accessible? Okay, and then universities have limited capacity for promoting FUSE initiatives or promoting innovation for inclusive development. Poverty alleviation is a research area, not a mandate of universities. Diba? We will talk about it, we will research it, but we will not be involved in it. But how about taking in poor students? Do they do that? Oh, you remember in I don't know whether it was also here, but when I was assistant dean for student affairs in the old College of Arts and Sciences in UP, we had the XDS, Experimental Democratization Students. Such a wonderful program. Kahit hindi ka pumasa sa UCAT, basta yung IQ mo, tsaka yung potential mo is high, tanggap ka. Diba? We had an experimental group of students who did not pass UCAT. Tanggap sila. That's the most inclusive program I've seen. Then bibigyan ka ng allowance. Then bibigyan ka ng teaching booster sessions. They will assign teachers who will be your coaches. Diba? After 4 years, because you are so hungry for development, mas magaling ka pa doon sa mga nag-UCAT. I know that because I saw the records. But why did we give it up? Nabagod na yung faculty. walang incentives. They were just doing it on their own. Diba? Can you see how it goes? But XDS, if we try to do that again, if I were president, a candidate for president, I will win on that platform, on XDS. Because it's the most inclusive thing you can think of as far as education, college education is concerned. Universities have no staying power with real problem, with real problems. So if you think a university will stay with the problem for 10 years, 20 years? Okay. Now, bakit research councils? Research councils inadequately perform their budget advice, research agenda setting, capacity building, knowledge management. Research councils are old boys clubs. In general, I'm talking in general. But masyadong malaki ang... You are already 50 years old, an associate of full professor, and you're still associate member of a research council. You have problems like that. I mean, do you have the 20-ish, 30-ish faculty members being members of research councils? Like the NRCP, you think? But it's a public organization, right? It's funded with government money. So why is that? Anyway, I'll just give you a sample. Mission. Challenges and opportunities. This is for universities. A problem sa mga universities is that research is dependent on I divided this into mission challenges, stakeholder challenges, resource challenges, methodology challenges, and capacity building challenges, which are your balanced scorecard. But I've said enough about challenges. Maybe you can just go through the slides so that we can. But there are opportunities like, for instance, a mandate. One way of dealing with it is you are not expected to be inclusive development all the way. I mean, you cannot transform the whole UP into an inclusive development-oriented university. It will take decades to do that. So the way to do it, you identify your unit and individual champions who will do that kind of work. Okay, so that's one way of doing it. And the policy-making bodies will also help. We need to revisit our stakeholder matrices. Bakit yung communities hindi kasama sa stakeholder ng university? Maybe Los Baños does that. But we don't do it the way the Thais do it. Sa kanila, meron silang 5 types of universities, from national to local. Yung national nila is pang-competition. Diba? Trying to get national standing among universities. Wala silang neighborhood. Talagang excellence lang sila. Pero yung kanilang lower level universities, they are the ones who teach the people what they need for livelihood. Anyway, so isang idea yun. So can we broaden our stakeholders? We need to establish relevance and responsiveness priorities. For instance, in research. Nasaan yung responsiveness and relevance? It's all validity, reliability, research design, right? Pero nasaan yung relevance and responsiveness? And building broad and intense networks. This is one idea. Why don't we assign equivalent service value to outreach services? For instance, nag-outreach ka, hindi ka nagpabayad. Pero can you value the kind of service that you provide to the community so that when you report it, there is a value to it? So that the university can later on, we did 5 million pesos worth of outreach services this year. Right? Bakit importante yon? So that the congressman, kung saan humihingi ng budget, will say, ah, i-validate ko nga kung totoo. Pero kung totoo, bibigyan ko sila ng double na pera. Diba? It's a good way of getting money. And our infirmary in UP did that. Dahil hindi sila makakuha ng pera, they asked every patient to sign a slip. Equivalent service value. Nagpapunod ka ng ngipin, 30 pesos. Okay. Nung tinotal nila yon, mas malaki pa doon sinihingin ka sa administration, napahiyaping administration. So binigyan sila ng computers. Diba? So, I mean, these are innovations. But I will stop there. I talk too much. Professors always do. They can hear you. Okay, so I think I've given you enough ideas about why we're doing this and what are some of the things we're doing. And the sustainability comes from curricular changes. We are trying to embed curricular changes. Because when you look at our curriculum now, when was the last time you checked your curriculum, and found out why you don't have any PhD students from my department? Wala na daw silang PhD students. Sabi ko, when was the last time you checked? You look at your curriculum. So, I mean, we have clients, we have customers, we have stakeholders. We have to delight our customers. Even if we are universities and research councils. Well, I'll end there. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Romero, for sharing with us the outcomes and learnings from the implementation of Unit SEA. So at this point, we now open the floor for any reactions or queries from our audience. If you have, kindly state your name. Organizational affiliation.
Students when they graduate to join also the forestry world, because foresters only in reforestation, you know, in the forestry industry, we lack some information that only agriculture graduates can forest. For example, in the first affiliated companies I worked in Mindanao, Agusan Norte, Agusan Sur, Bukidnon, and Misamis Oriental. What I suggested, what we did was, we planted bananas, abaca, and fruit tree like lanzones in the forest. The lanzones provided feed for monkeys, birds, wild pigs, deer, and we had bird this almost every day. Free. You can hunt there. Then, the bananas, if you plant them above the rows of trees, they will serve as irrigation systems. And then, we planted abaca below the rows of trees, and here is this provide livelihood for farmers. Instead of they smuggling the trees, they have a livelihood because they now can harvest the abaca for fibers, the banana fruits for food and livelihood, and then the fruit trees will provide them wild animals for their patties. Instead of buying meat from the market, they just shoot. In the forest. So we keep these native people, the people out there busy on the livelihood in living rather than smuggling the trees in the forest. Now the second suggestion I would like to suggest is, well, In the second company, affiliated companies I worked for in Mindanao for 4 years. What I did now, after some researching in the industry, I did this in our 3 farms of 22 hectares. I planted 4 species of trees at different times. 1 species for electric post, which was 8 pesos per tree. 2 species for furniture, which was approximately 10 pesos, 10,000 pesos per tree. And then the 4th species was for paper industry, which we supplied to the paper making companies. And that gave us, when we saw this, at different years, approximately from 300 pesos to 500 pesos per hectare. And well, now we compute 22 hectares, 300 to 500,000 per hectare. Well, do not wonder that I'm now a millionaire. And then, at the Pacific Lumber Company, the first company that I worked with, the late Dean Calixto Mabesa Forestry.
What we did was, sir, could you kindly keep it short and sweet, baka po may iba pa?
This could be done by the colleges and universities. We reversed the system of teaching. Instead of the students going to school, the students work there, and we teachers went there to the field. The other classes that are going to the field. Then they were scholars. We gave them half pay, but the half pay we gave them food, free meriendas, but we pocketed their money because after serving a year or two, we sent them to college universities, and we spent the money we got from their salaries for their school in the colleges. Thank you very much. This could be done, I think. Thank you very much.
Yes, that is much appreciated because the sources of innovations are really different perspectives looking at the same problem. In fact, I'll give an example now. Because I do a lecture before COA auditors, senior auditors, and I teach them about Philippine administrative system and so on. But I found out that they have a lot of findings that can be used as evidence against corrupt people. Except that much of this evidence is just in their website. I mean, they post it. And they leave it to the prosecutors to pick the data. Ganyan yung lumalabas about plunder, they tell us it's there. It's just that somebody needs to process this data. And so I ask them, so why don't you process it? Oh, and then they say, actually we work with the ombudsman, but ngayon lang nila nakita yung problema. Na the auditors have the data, but they don't know how to appear in court to make the evidence stand out and convince the judge. So it is as if they need additional competencies to unlock the secrets in the data that they have. On the other hand, these prosecutors who know how to play them in court, hindi naman nila maintindihan yung figures. So, just because these two come from different traditions and different competencies and they are not trained together, they could not get the team effort that is required, which is more prosecutions of corrupt officials. So, this is just an idea that if you create opportunities for foresters and agriculturers and sociologists and development workers, which you can do using, again, TOP. Actually, we and our team can process the thoughts of any organization, any group of people in 3 hour stops. We will know your problems, we will know what you think, we can make you agree. Just using meta cards and colored sticker dots and facilitation techniques, which will require other people doing less systematic ways, 2 days to get that kind of result. But what we're really saying is that pati doon sa discussion, community engagement, may technology na, technology of participation ng tao nila. And we should use them. If we use them among students, ito, face-to-face pa. But how are you using your Facebook, di ba? And how are you selecting your friends on Facebook so that you have a grasp of what's happening in the world and in the concentric circles of your interests? Because if you choose your friends wisely, and if you are sufficiently active, that will be twice the college degree that you get. The learning you get from Facebook just by interacting with people is twice the college degree that you get. Can you imagine ang bilis nung repartee, exchange of information, at kung hindi tama sinasabi mo, sasabihin ka agad sa'yo. Hindi tama sinasabi. Like, I went through your website yesterday. So I saw this article about the paper of Dr. Borte about the cheapest rice. Who produces the cheapest rice, right? So I posted the article. Immediately, sinonoy O plus. Sagot ka dyan. Hindi tama yung datos ng SEARCA. Sabi niya. Cannot be true that Filipinos spend 69 man days to tend to a hectare of rice, and that the Vietnamese only spend 23, and the Thais spend only 10 days tending to a hectare of rice. Sabi niya. Then, pasok naman yung isang economist, si Mark Evidente. They are not inconsistent, sabi niya. Kasi, yung 69 days na Pilipino, mas malaki naman ang output niya. So, kung talagang gusto mong i-compare, you will have to go by a calculation of per metric ton things like that. But I got an immediate economics lesson in 15 minutes. Diba? From a business day economist columnist, and then another economist, and then somebody from forestry said, lahat po ng mga pinapadala, ito na yung team song, lahat po ng mga pinapadala natin dyan sa Thailand, ganyan-ganyan, nanggaling po yan dito sa LD. sabi ko nila, amen. Di ba? Oh, now, in a 1.5 hour classroom, do you get that kind of engagement? Now, you put that together, side by side, that's, in my estimate, the equivalent of 2 college degrees if you run them simultaneously. And, kaya ko sinasabi yan kasi yung matututunan mo, hindi lang yung sa field mo, kasi hindi yung teacher mo ang nagdidictate kung ano yung focus mo. Pwedeng somebody who is interested in your field but brings in something that he is interested in, then suddenly you learn. So, it should not be happenstance that we have Facebook. The problem of the Philippines is that we've been fragmented coming from 7,100 islands. That was the main problem why we could not govern ourselves. We are geographically fragmented. Suddenly ngayon, everything is connected, which is why we are moving. Haven't you seen? We are moving now faster than other societies. And our ability to make consensus decisions is bigger and faster now. It's not because of leaders, it's because we simply solve our social distance, geographic distance problem. The cell phone is what is making us a nation. I'll talk.
Your initiative, kung ano gagawin mo? Ito, mapis. Yung initiative niyo po on IID, very interesting, especially yung balance scorecard. Yung results po and yung mga innovations introduced in the IIP program. Have you shared this with the CHED? Because perhaps it's a good way of influencing the direction of the universities in the Philippines. Meron na po ba kayong discussion, are you in discussion with CHED?
Wala pa. No, we have not, but we will be very glad to do it. What we have done, what we have been doing is to try to muscle in into the NSTP field. We talked to PUP, which has the biggest number of students. I think talagang NSTP umaabot ng 10,000 at any one line. And we've already given them IID, and so they are. Now USC is inviting us to speak to 1,000 NSTP students to tell them what IIT is about. But our idea really is that, for instance, in Ateneo, a student from elementary to college goes through several service learning, formation, for religion, secular programs, which if you put together might be as long as 3 months. Diba? Pero papitsi-pitsi kasi yung kanilang mga teachers hindi naman nag-uusap. Meron silang formation sa elementary, may formation sa high school, may formation sa college, religious formation, meron NSTP formation, meron values formation, pero hindi sila what if you suddenly put them under a framework and then consider that a holistic, inclusive development engagement course, right? So anyway, but where do you feel them? Naisip lang namin. For instance, yung sa mga trains natin, LRT, MRT. A lot of provincialas, first time nilang pupunta doon. Hindi nila alam kung paano kukuha ng ticket, kung paano susok-sok yung card, things like that. If you feed your NSTP students there, they can help the PWD, they can help these old people who need some guidance, they can give map reading, you have maps there, but it will show you that there is a caring society. You will be helping those who are at the BOP. You will not be helping the rich because the rich can take care of themselves. But how about the poor? Galing ng Bulacan, pupunta sa PGH. Akala niyo, madali yun. Pagbaba niya sa recto, hindi niya alam kung saan door ng LRT siya aakyat. Magtatanong pa yan, di ba? And then, kung bastos yung guard na nakausap niya, baka hindi pa siya umabot doon sa rektor. Anyway, what we're really saying is that there are so many opportunities for us to look at. But I would be willing to discuss this with Chad and Chair Xavier. By the way, we were able to convince Ateneo that they are going to give us the NSTP for Development Studies next sem. Kami ang mag-handle niya. So we will show how it can be done better. But these are also innovations which then you need to write up so that it can be shared. Because if you don't write it up, it cannot be shared. Which is what is the problem with our indigenous peoples. Oral tradition sila. By the way, even as educated Filipinos, oral tradition pa rin tayo, we don't write things. You attend meetings, you cannot remember everything, so why is it that you're not taking notes? Something like that. Anyway, but I welcome the idea of sharing this.
Yeah, one last question.
Sure, I'd like to clarify po. You mentioned that you give research grants. I know it's in your website, pero can you clarify on this? Is this for innovations or for inventions?
Unfortunately, the project has ended, so we cannot give grants anymore. But when we were giving grants, we were giving 10,000 to 20,000 pesos, dollars worth to applicants. And that was really the intention. The money comes from IDRC, and we are the fund managers. We preside over promotions and so on. And we also did that for our IIT fellows program. So I think outsourcing is a very good way of getting inputs from people out there. Unfortunately, we don't have that money anymore. Until or unless they give us a part two.